assistants Nick and Joe. Massage every corner of his drone. Phone a cassette that is on the home. But in the meantime, they'll play the greatest clips they find.
VCR Party Live. VCR Party Live.
Anna Melinda.
Well, hello, Melinda. Hi, everybody. Welcome to the show, VCR Party, the show where Nick and I watch VHS tapes all day long. That's all we do. Wake up in the morning and we watch VHS tapes until we go to bed at night.
And, you know, we celebrated the one-year anniversary of VCR Party last week. We talked about the origin of Hello, Melinda, so if you want to see that, go back to last week's episode.
Is today the actual one-year anniversary of it? Or when's the actual?
It was last Monday. It was last Wednesday.
Last Wednesday.
And so we celebrated, I think, a day early, but that's fine.
Okay.
But we have another anniversary to celebrate this. We just celebrate everything here.
We have too many corners and too many anniversaries.
Too many anniversaries, but we'll tell you about that in a minute. We have a special guest today, Chris Gethard, you might know him from Broad City, played Alana's boss.
I know him from Public Access. He's a Public Access dude through and through, and he'll tell the whole story, but like he was on a Public Access station for 3 years.
After he was famous.
After he got a sitcom on Comedy Central.
Yes. So it was
a weird
journey.
Had the sitcom on Comedy Central, then he went and did 3 years of Public Access. That's not usually how it works.
We've queued up some Public Access highlights. I want to know his insights about Public Access. So Chris will be here. But first, we have to do our found footage classics.
Yep.
So this one, we've been showing a lot from Volume 1. We've been feeling nostalgic. And it is the...
There's John and Johnny on the cover.
Yep, John and Johnny are on the cover. This is from Volume 1 and 2 on our website. You can get this. And this is Mix C. This is the very first video we found. And the reason I'm showing this is because I think tomorrow is the 15-year anniversary of the first Found Footage Festival show.
Oh, you're right.
And what do you remember about that show?
Well, what do you mean? Like the first official one?
Yes,
like
the first one we did in Brooklyn.
Oh, okay. Well, there's the Rafifi one.
Rafifi. That's it's the anniversary of that.
Yep. What do I remember? I don't remember much from that one. I remember the...
You don't know, we do a show called the Found Footage Festival, which is our live touring show. You probably know. I don't know why I'm saying this. But even we don't know the distinction between VCR Party and Found Footage
Festival.
We don't.
We have to figure this out, actually.
But basically, VCR Party is this more looser show. And
I would say the lower quality version.
That's right. You're
of
watching
Found
the worst
Festival.
Version.
Yes,
yeah.
Exactly.
But Found Footage Festival,
it's the free version, though.
That's true. We do an annual show, and we have toured that for the last 15 years now. And so on that anniversary, I wanted to look back and show the very first video that kind of kicked us off with collecting. This was found in 1991 at the break room of the McDonald's where I was working in high school. And our intern borrowed the actual tape. Jackson is watching that probably in his dorm room at NYU right now. So I have a dub that I made a long time ago to show some coworkers.
Is it from Letterman?
Yeah, when I was there, I wanted to show coworkers, so I had a little screening party in the office. But so I just queued it up to the window scene. Figured we'd watch this.
Yeah, that's a good one.
To celebrate 15 years. So keep the anniversary gifts coming. The well wishes. Here's Mick C, everybody.
It's on the container, in case you forget.
Oh, okay, thanks.
Well, let's wash a few windows, shall we?
Ready when you are.
Chris, windows are real important to our image. Smudges and streaks just don't make it at McDonald's. Mm-hmm. So, please wash the windows as soon as possible in the morning before the customers arrive, and keep them clean throughout the day. And it's very important that your work doesn't disturb our customers. They're our chief concern.
Mm-hmm. I'll keep that in mind.
Good. So, step one, take your brush and dip it in the bucket.
It's like a horse brush.
And brush the solution on.
Do they really do this?
Now, outline the window first. And fill in the outline using horizontal strokes. Next, take the squeegee and edge the top and sides of the window.
They're paying you $4.75
an hour. Pull down from
the
top to the middle,
to do this.
Wiping the squeegee after each stroke.
It's got a loofah.
When you get to the bottom half of the window, use horizontal strokes, wiping the squeegee after each pass.
This was in Illinois.
Until you get to the very bottom of the window. Then follow the squeegee with a sponge.
No.
Wipe the mullions dry.
They call those mulligans.
Then stand back and look at it once and look at it twice and spot clean that window with a paper towel.
Oh, the guy in the background.
That's it. That's the way to do it. Buff that window. And don't stop cleaning until you see McSee.
Oh, what do you mean until I see McSee?
There's a lot going on here.
Don't stop.
That guy's exhaling a cigarette.
Don't stop cleaning until you see McSee.
That's it. That's the way to do
seems
it.
Like
Buff that window.
McSee.
And don't stop cleaning until you see McSee.
Oh, what do you mean until I see McSee?
Well, they say if you're really good, you'll see McSee. Now that the windows are clean, you're ready to clean the rest of the dining room.
We should watch this. Whole
here's
thing.
Where McDonald's
well,
really shines.
That's the other thing I'm going
to
mention.
We're counting on you, Chris, to keep up that reputation.
Okay.
It's up to you to make sure that everything is exactly the way our customers expect it to be. You'll be cleaning the dining room every day from top to bottom, and I mean that literally. I'll show you how in a moment, but first, let me show you what you'll need. A feather duster?
All right, that's about enough, McSee. But the whole video is incredible. We have it memorized. And because we're doing these monthly, what we call the EP mode episodes, so if you're mm-hmm. on Patreon, you're a $10 donor, you can watch us watch a whole video.
Mm-hmm.
And
I want to watch that one. I vote for that one.
So we have three up for bids. McSee will be one of them.
One Kid's Opinion. Which is another great one.
And I think the final one will be Mr. T's Be Somebody or Be Somebody Fool. We're feeling nostalgic for our 15-year anniversary.
That was also one of our first ones, too.
So some of the very first finds from the 90s that started us.
I would highly recommend McSee. I think everybody should see that from start to finish.
And maybe we could bring in a guest for that one. I don't know. It'd be fun. But I do remember them calling it the Mulligans. They would say...
You remember that when you were working?
Yeah, when I was working there, they'd be like, clean the mulligans down with like damp cloth. And I'd be like, what the hell are mulligans? Those are the little windowsills.
Never heard that.
And there's a word for the threshold of the door that you had to clean too, like between the outside and inside.
We'll,
I can't remember.
We'll watch the video and we'll find out.
All right. What else do we want to say? We have shows coming up in Calgary, I think, in next week?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Two shows. We're going to do Volume 9. We're going to premiere Volume 9. We still haven't really finished it. We got to work on it
We're scrambling these next couple weeks.
Yeah. But that, what is that, April 24th?
The 25th and 26th in Calgary.
25th is the Volume 9. Then 26th, we're doing After Dark. We're doing our dirty show. So.
And if you're not in Calgary, which you probably aren't, then we'll hit the road after
Most
that.
People aren't.
But this is kind of a surprise. It's our, you know, an anniversary is a birthday, and we were born... tomorrow, 15 years ago.
We came out of our mom's vaginas,
That's right.
Right.
Yep, that's what I meant. And this video was sent by Bob Hedges, who's our patron who just sends us great stuff all the time.
Well, he's the one who sent me the ear cleaner.
Yeah, and so you have Bob to thank for that.
Yeah, but I'm not allowed to show that anymore, right?
No, you've been banned.
Yeah.
Well, I think everyone's going to be very happy about this happy birthday video. That is a video stripogram from 1989. And this is very much like card sets, the video greeting cards.
Yeah.
Because on the back here, it's from and to, and you could send this to
somebody.
I think
it's like Mr. Nasty, too, because Mr. Nasty was like, you send this to your buddy, and he'll insult your buddy.
Your boss, you know. So this one is a happy birthday stripogram, and they waste no time getting into the stripping.
That is a great cover.
And this was still sealed. When I got it, I had to open the plastic to get this open. So this is a pristine copy. It's E2E Productions from Burbank, California. And we'll play a little bit of a birthday, happy birthday to us, to the Found Footage Festival with this birthday stripogram.
Does it show nudity?
I didn't get that far.
Okay.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, I like how it's starting.
And the soundtrack.
What animal does it look like?
Lion.
I doubt that was gonna be me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Steve, what do you think? Thank you. Especially right there. I got to this part that I wanted to show because, okay, he's got these little shorts on.
Yeah.
But guys just don't have that many layers. They don't have bras, they don't, have garters. So they have to invent layers for male strippers. So he takes these off and he's got a little
The Speedo.
Banana hammock type Speedo thing. And I was like, wow, well, they really got down, what more can he do apart from take the shirt off? Well, then he reveals. You'll see. But he reveals he's got another Speedo that's the exact same size underneath.
Oh, okay.
But it's pink. So he's just basically like...
It's like a magic trick.
Yeah. Or you know those videos where people just put on a ton of shirts, you know, so they're wearing like 100 shirts. Decided to just put some smoke in here. yeah. Well, I thought he was going to take off the other.
Oh, he tears it.
I have some trouble tearing this off, too. Yeah. Not effortless. Yeah, all right. but, all right. Well, I don't
know if
it was
worth it.
But
does he ever take it off?
Yeah, he does. He takes off the, it's slightly smaller thong. I think we'll stop there because I don't want to see if it gets further, but happy birthday.
Yeah, so, happy birthday to you too.
Yeah, so thanks, Bob, and keep sending stuff. What is the 15-year gift for an anniversary?
I thought it was a really tiny thong.
Oh, a tiny thong.
Yeah,
okay.
It's a really tiny.
Well, send them in, folks.
Black and pink. Yep.
don't actually send those.
Don't.
In.
Yeah.
No, I know how people get watch this show.
Yeah. The clowns. Too many clowns.
We might have to stop.
Yeah.
Stop sending the clowns.
Yeah. Please stop with the clowns.
We have plenty. so are we ready?
Yeah. Let's do it. Chris Gethard. He's our guest. He's great. He's a public access veteran. And so we lined up a bunch of public access clips for him. And
Chris Gethard.
Did we already preface him? Do we?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think we said.
You know who he is.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right.
Here comes Chris.
Here he is.
Chris, thanks for being here. We're so excited today because we have a lot of public access TV lined up for you.
And we wanted to have you on for so long because, like, I mean, you started in public access, right?
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah. Well, my TV show was at a theater in New York called the Upright Citizens Brigade, and I couldn't get anyone to buy it. So I was like, screw it, I'll go to public access.
Brilliant. That's hearing like legends of you. Like this is like maybe like
that's
15
cool.
years ago or so. Everybody's like, have you heard of this Chris Gethard guy? He does this public access show.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I started doing stuff at UCB 19 years ago. I went to public access in 2011.
Oh, okay. So it wasn't that long.
So yeah, that's when I jumped over to, after my career had kind of stalled out and failed. Like I think we met probably around like 2004
or 2005. I think so,
yeah. And I was like an up and comer.
Right.
And then things really went.
And things, yeah.
Some weird directions and I wound up on public access TV, so yeah.
Well, I love it and I feel like, I mean, this show that we're doing is not that much different than public access TV because it's you know, airing to a very specific audience. And
we're making it up as we go along, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But what was it about public access, like how did you find that process?
Well, I used to teach improv classes and this dude named Keith Bethay, he was a student of mine, real good dude, and I was at a bar one night and I'd gotten a reputation in New York for doing a lot of weird stuff. This probably started around like 2006 and 2007. That was when like the legend building started to happen, when I was just doing like really just odd shows around New York. This dude Keith was like, you know, I think your show would be a really good public access show, and I didn't know what to make of that. I was like, I don't know. And I was like laughing about it. He's like, well, I work at the studio in New York. I work at the Manhattan Neighborhood Network. And I was like, oh, that's interesting. And I grew up on a lot of like weird sort of public access. Also like the UHF channels, you know, like.
Yeah,
like,
you grew up in New Jersey, right?
Northern New Jersey. Okay. And there was this guy named Uncle Floyd in New Jersey.
Oh, very familiar with Uncle Floyd.
You know Uncle Floyd.
Yeah, like, yeah.
And I immediately had this vision of like, I just loved him. Me and my brother loved Uncle Floyd. And I was like, he had a homemade TV show and everybody loved it. And it was like really strange.
Was that a UHF show?
It was kind of like, from what I found out, because I later emailed Uncle Floyd to try to get him on my show. He smacked down by far harder than anyone else who ever rejected being a guest on the Chris Gethard show. It was Uncle Floyd. We tried two or three times, smacked it down so hard. He was on sort of like pay for PlayStations, where you would pay a fee to be on, and then you could sell advertising to make money and make your money back.
It was a kid's show, right?
It wasn't. It wasn't.
Yeah.
He was like dressed like an old vaudevillian, and he did a lot of bits with puppets. But a lot of it was really inappropriate, and then when his show would fall apart and things would go wrong, they'd just leave it in, and you'd hear the cameraman be like, Floyd, we want to go home. Like you'd, and then, but then he'd cut to the musical guest, and it would be Dee Dee Ramone. So you'd be like, what is this? You'd be like, wait, what is this? And it was really cool.
Yeah.
And
what was his rejection led to you? Do you remember specifically?
I basically wrote him right when we went to public access, maybe before the first episode we ever did. I wrote Uncle Floyd, and I was like, you know, I grew up on Uncle Floyd, and I always thought it was amazing that you did your own TV show, and I have found that the standard entertainment industry does not want to take me seriously, so I'm going to go do it myself, and I'm going to do it on public access. And I had said to him, you had a public access show that really inspired me, and that made him furious. So it was his manager, to this day.
Why did that make him mad?
Well, to this day, I don't know if it was really his manager or if it was him. I don't know.
Right.
I think maybe it was his manager. For a long time, I doubted it. He basically said, like, Uncle Floyd was never public access. He always respected himself as an artist. He made money for his... He goes, the honest truth is that the gas crisis in the 70s made it impossible for comedians to go on the road and make money. It was so expensive to travel. So that's why he started his show. And it never would have happened if he was able to just go out and be, you know,
right.
on the road. And
there's a secret shame there?
It was almost like a weird... It did make me very bummed in the sense that, especially for people from New Jersey and Long Island, back in that era, I think he is beloved. And I just hope he knows.
We have some fans of our show who have asked us about... In fact, we have an Uncle Floyd t-shirt somewhere around here that somebody sent us.
It's a really good fit. I would imagine that you guys come across a lot of stuff that is poor man's Uncle Floyd very often.
Yeah, I think people
very often
tried to imitate him.
Yeah, I certainly did.
I feel like almost like Pee-wee's Playhouse is kind of that. I wonder which came first.
I think Uncle Floyd by
really?
Many years.
Yeah. Okay.
Uncle Floyd was a guy in New Jersey where it was like every Italian kid I know had like a framed picture of Uncle Floyd in their basement. Like you could meet Uncle Floyd down at the carnival,
wow.
The street fair. He'd just be around.
Was it on in the mornings then, like before school?
Totally random times.
Oh, okay.
You had to be one of these kids who was just like clicking up into like those upper level channels where
right.
you just get completely insane stuff.
Well, I wanted to show you something that we kind of grew up watching over and over. It's a public access show. And then I kind of wanted to get what your appeal was, you know, what was it about public access that made you drawn to it?
Yeah.
But there was, in high school, we used to just watch public access on Friday or Saturday nights. We grew up in a small town in Wisconsin.
Uh-huh.
Wasn't a lot happening. So friends would come over and we just turn on TV from like 10 to 2 in the morning and watch late night public access. And this show always came on. It was called One Kid's Opinion. And it was just one episode of the show, a kid's review of
it's
Disneyland.
It's probably the first video that we ever started collecting.
It was one of them. Like, yeah, it was like 1993 or something.
Yeah, it's like one of our first of all.
Always would have a tape in the VCR, and then if something good came on, we'd hit record. So we missed the first part of this show and then hit record and got the rest of it. It's a kid's review of Disney World. And, let's just play it.
He's 12 years old, and, like, you know, it feels weird, that you're laughing at a 12-year-old, but we've since become friends with this kid.
Really?
So, yeah. So it's okay to laugh at this.
And you got to admire his ambition here, too.
Yeah. No, it's actually really good. He did a 27-minute show, unedited, all the way through. No cue cards.
Live to tape.
Not live. You couldn't call in.
No.
Okay.
So we'll show you some One Kid's Opinion here.
It's actually aired in Evanston, Illinois, but it aired constantly, too. We know a lot of people who have also seen it outside of us.
Really? Just in Wisconsin?
Yeah.
Hi, my name's Mark. For years, I had been begging my parents to take me to Disney World. And last spring, my wish finally came true. So here I am with Disney World, One Kid's Opinion. Another ride in Adventureland, I give 4 Mickeys. Pirates of the Caribbean.
It's his rating system.
Perfect.
Wonderfully lifelike robots.
Those hand gestures are just...
And although the lines are long,
a best of that you guys have edited? Or is
this is an edited version.
So these weren't his jump cuts necessarily.
Next
no.
to go to my favorite
I just want to rewind. There's a good line.
I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
No, that's okay. Feel free. This
feel free to talk.
I do really love his inability to control his head.
Yeah.
And although the lines are long, it's worth it. Ahoy, mateys. Next to go to my favorite
feels like a marionette, doesn't
he? And in the Magic Kingdom. The Big Thunder Mountain Railroad. I give this old Western thriller 5 Mickeys. Highlights include going through an old mine shaft.
It's a weird time to take a drink.
And going around on a tilt at 360 degrees. Fantasyland. One of the rides is
a little fidgety.
The Amazing Dumbo. I give this one Mickey.
No!
Yeah.
Sorry, Dumbo.
Because, well, it's a good thing to take little kids on because it does feature the Dumbo character. In spite of the fact you can find that at amusement parks everywhere, even local fairs that come to town. All it is you just go
does
up
not
and
suffer
around.
Fools.
He's not wrong.
No,
I'm 100% with him on that.
Epcot yeah. Was in the Wonders of Life Pavilion.
That was classic.
Which is located right outside the Jumping Waters.
Is he filming in flip-flops?
Yes.
I don't fit until yeah. now.
Okay. Shorts in between the jumping waters.
Can I just rewind? Just
well,
for the,
see, this is, I mean, you've had to deal with this too. Sometimes the technical things don't go right. And so the person switching the background was
hold
not.
Hold on. Sorry. I wanted it to be perfect here.
Right.
I mean, before there were memeable
the
moments.
Life Pavilion.
This is memeable.
Which is located
think.
Right outside the Jumping Waters. Yeah.
The eye roll.
A true diva moment.
Yes.
From Mark.
From the Wonders of Life.
I just love how pink his face
is
suddenly is. No.
Michael Jackson's Captain EO. Well, that's something else, which I won't bother to review right now.
Yeah.
Not even worth
denied.
It.
Denied.
Ahead of his time.
It has proven
World,
true. It's gone
it's
now, right?
It's gone, yeah.
It's been removed.
If you're not,
yep.
Well, I also enjoy talking to you. Goodbye.
Amazing.
And then that's vanished. He just disappeared.
That's how I think we should end every VCR party.
Yeah,
just say goodbye.
And then disappear.
And then we disappear yeah. with our hand like right here.
Yeah.
I love it.
So you should see the whole thing. Like the full thing.
Now,
what, how long is it? 25, 27 minutes? Half hour?
Yeah, it's a half hour.
How
yeah.
did it affect his life? Because he went, if it played all the time, this meant he went to school and it followed him.
That's right. He went to college and then he's told us that people would come up and be like, one kid's opinion. I remember this.
Because they played it constantly on that channel.
Yeah.
It was
yeah.
always on.
You got this reminds me a lot. This is a tangent, not related to public access. My brother had that happen to him. My brother was on the first season of the PBS game show Where in the World is Carmen Sandiego.
Oh, really?
And he was on an episode where he behaved so bizarrely. And if you remember, that show aired constantly
oh, yeah.
on PBS. In the first season, they didn't know it was going to be a hit. So it was just like the same 10
oh,
episodes.
Oh, we watched it in middle school.
Over
yeah,
and
yeah.
Over and over.
I probably saw your brother.
My
on,
brother
yeah.
was a legendarily cringeworthy disaster contestant on Where in the World is Carmen Sandiego. And it has followed him.
Really?
For
what did
a long
he do?
Time.
He just lost, or like what did
well,
he?
Well, you know, the first kid was like, I want to be a heart surgeon, and the other kid was like, I would love to work in politics, and my brother's like, I want to either be a baseball manager or stand-up comedian, and then they made him tell a joke, but the producers wrote the joke for him, and it made no sense, and he bombed, and he keeps.
But they like, kept it in.
Kept it in, and he keeps leaning way into the microphone every answer, and the host is like, Greg, you don't have to do that, and he's like, okay, I'm so sorry. It's just that the whole thing is just
wow.
a very uncomfortable
oh.
disaster. You guys
so
would enjoy it
he
greatly.
He lives in Philadelphia, right?
He does, yeah.
Our buddy
does.
Chip, I think, is friends
Chip
with
Chantry,
him.
Chip yes. Chantry, yes. He's worked with you guys a lot. Yeah.
Yeah, so I would love to have Greg on and show that clip if he still has a tape of
he
it.
He loves
so
nothing more than attention.
Really?
So
okay, good.
Oh, yeah. He,
it exists? He still has it?
He has it. It's on the internet. He once did a... it went on Reddit and yeah. went all over, and then some people were like, we should find this guy and do an AMA. And my brother then did an AMA without researching at all what Reddit is, which is a foolish maneuver to
oh,
not
yeah.
research the medium. And then the Reddit AMA arguably is just as big of a cringeworthy disaster.
Really?
Oh, boy. Because people on Reddit are trying to be funny, but
yeah.
it's like Reddit in jokes and stuff.
Yeah.
And then my brother would just be like, you know, like, fuck you internet tool. You want to sit behind a keyboard? And it's like, no, this is just what people
That's
on
what
Reddit
I love
do.
That it all came full circle, though.
And it's then it just that crashed and burned, too. It was really...
Oh, boy. We got to have Greg on.
Speaking of disasters, this is another one taped off of TV.
Mm-hmm.
In college, I always had a tape in the VCR, and we'd watch public access, like, you know,
it, yeah.
2 o'clock in the morning.
I really like this. I was a tape collector in my own, but not... I was more like animal disaster videos. And
oh, yeah. What do you mean animal disaster videos?
There used to be a lot of like...
Trials of life?
Like late night, like this is just a show where you get to watch like lion kill a thing.
Oh, yeah.
Like, a lot of, like, and I think a lot of them were trying to sell tape sets of this stuff.
Trials of Life, I remember they were called.
I would tape a lot of those, like, the free sections they would show.
You're really into Animal Death.
I liked Animal Death. I liked one that's become played out with the internet, but used to be a thing, news faux pas.
Oh, yeah. Bloopers?
News bloopers were huge.
Huge fans. Yeah.
That footage of that guy, one of the greatest tapes I owned was the footage of that gymnast who's trying to go off the pommel horse and slips and goes chest first into it.
Oh, that's a classic.
Sorry, I just hit my mic, but classic. So I did, and then Andy Kaufman.
I wish that we would have known about your love of bloopers. We could have arranged
a lot of news.
I would love to
next
come
time
back.
You come back on.
Please have me
it'll
back.
It'll be all news bloopers.
This is up my alley. I love a good blooper.
I like even like mediocre news bloopers. Right. Like, they don't even have to be that great.
Right.
So this one, it came on at like 2 o'clock in the morning on maybe like a Sunday night or something.
And you caught it.
And I caught it, and it's this guy, Wayne Brian Meyer. It's from Eau Claire, Wisconsin. And he's one of these, see, I'm gonna do, my set tonight is gonna be darker public access. Nick is doing like
charming.
lighter side.
Well, I can speak
stuff.
To both.
Okay, great.
1,000%. I have stories to tell you about public access.
Oh, I cannot wait.
Okay, so this is Wayne Brian Meyer, and I'm going to show you the end of, so I only got the end of the first episode, and then they cut off the second episode, maybe like 2 minutes in. So we're going to watch the end, we're just going to watch what I have.
Mm-hmm. Well, human beings, dying!
Yeah, this is familiar.
Wayne Brian Meyer? Yeah, we've had it in previous shows before.
Just in
and dying, your fellow human beings. Dying!
What he has on the
diaper advertising. The Laxi.
Longerie.
Ramping up to the Reagan administration.
Jobs Bill Rock.
His audience doesn't even deserve the visual aid anymore.
Like when the director's just keep it rolling.
Convenient way to tape it, because then he can save it for.
He could have just thrown it.
Exactly.
He could have just thrown it, but he daintily.
Why all the pomp and circumstance behind that?
I'm taking my easel and I'm going home. Oh, and again, faithfully unscrewing it. He could just pick the whole thing up.
Oh, I just.
Horrible audio.
So
that's the end of the first episode.
Right in line.
I mean, I could. I mean, I'm enjoying the songs. Maybe I'll just keep
it. Ombudsman of Eau Claire, like self-appointed.
Well, I will tell you. Oh, that's wild. Have you ever tracked him down?
I've written him several letters.
To the P.O. Box.
Yeah, never got any response. And I looked him up, too, and he's not listed, so.
I would go so far as to say that the first two clips you've chosen show the yin and yang of public access that still exists today.
Yeah.
In a real
big
way.
How so?
Well, I love public access so much, and I'm going to have a lot of fun joking about it tonight, but
yes.
I want to be clear. It was a beautiful, transformative thing in my life that I think is actually one of the most incredible things.
Welcome to Wisconsin Cursed 9.
Oh, God.
Put a bookmark. That's how it aired. That's not our tape.
Yeah, that's his. That's what he turned in.
I think that's the old Tonight Show set, isn't it? Johnny Carson?
Yeah, that's the one.
In the city of moral outrages like the sidewalk issue, or the state of Wisconsin, with umpteen moral outrages like the driver's license reinstatement fee, prohibition against steel studded snow tires, and ad nauseum ad infinitum.
What's an assassin's name?
United States of America, God's country, the greatest country on the face of this green earth. I'll give you three warnings. This show contains dramatic negative imprecations, which will be terribly upsetting, will cause many people to get all riled up, and I'm warning you three times that this show contains formal orders to various individuals and groups to drop dead in the name of Jesus Christ. So I advise you to turn off your TV set.
Yes.
Or turn on something educational. Turn on a Walt Disney cartoon.
Some animal death.
I warn you that this show contains dramatic negative imprecations. It will be terrible.
I looked it up.
Some individuals,
it's a curse.
And I warn you to turn off your TV set.
I looked it up today.
Curse 9.
Yeah, because I thought he was saying
implications?
Yeah, that's what I thought he meant, but I looked it up, and it is a word.
This program, Wisconsin Curse 9, contains dramatic negative imprecations. It will be terribly upsetting to some people. This is your third and final warning to turn off your TV set or turn on another program.
No easel this time, huh?
I want to just show you how it ends, or how cable access decided to...
Oh, God.
So he starts reading from the newspaper.
Just local headlines?
Yeah.
Ranting?
Yep.
The things he was so pissed about were the prohibition on steel-studded snow tires on snowmobiles.
This is how it ends. This is exactly how I taped it.
Society and the political process when religions turn to lobbying and political pressure.
And the auction.
And they're auctioning off a toaster.
Yeah.
So he just couldn't control how it ended.
Being on a pastel electronic bread machine.
So that's Wayne. That's Perfect. A Wayne Brian Meyer tape. Perfect.
I think you have a similar philosophy though. Like public access is so strange and wonderful, and that's why we love it so much. All its foibles, that's why we like it as well.
Well, look, it's like here's the thing. The first things I want to say are the positive, which is they let anyone have a show.
Yes.
So like the first clip you showed, little kid shows up and is like, I want to have a TV show. Yeah, no questions asked. Like absolutely. And I want to make clear, too, in New York, one of the things that's beautiful about it, too, is it really is used as a community resource sometimes. Like, there's different neighborhoods that are being gentrified, and, you know, some of them, let's say, like, East Harlem or Washington Heights that have had, like, longstanding ethnic communities, a lot of those communities have shows, and then everybody watches them, they communicate with each other. It's beautiful.
Right.
Yeah. It's beautiful.
Right.
New York is great for public access.
It's
dying off in other parts of the country, but New York is
pretty
strong.
New York is staying strong, and Brooklyn has a great station, too. I was on MNN, but then you also have the Waynes of the world.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Like, you have that, too, of, oh, that's a guy who clearly everyone in his life is like, Wayne, we're tired. We can't do this anymore. And he finds public access. We had, you guys will love this. I could talk all night. They regarded me as a Hollywood interloper. There were about...
Oh, no.
Was this in 2011 when you first started doing cable access?
When I started doing cable access, everyone liked us because we were funny and we showed up, we worked hard. My show had been at UCB. It had gotten some press. They were very excited to have us there. My buddy Keith told me the studio, he was like, you can air live, you can take phone calls, you can curse, you can do whatever you want. I was like, why would we not do...
Yeah.
I was like, how much does it cost? Free. Fill out the paperwork. Take the classes. I was like... Amazing.
Yeah.
We can get a 3-camera studio with a live calling capability for free. Let's
do
it. So they loved having us there. Once we started picking up momentum, we became kind of the golden children. Got a lot of press. And they started letting us break some rules. Like we could bring food into the studio. But it's because they knew we would clean it up.
Yeah. Right.
Other people would come and leave a mess.
You weren't being a big shot.
I could see that ruffling some feathers though.
And there was a crew of about a dozen people cut from Wayne's cloth who they would put me on email lists with all of them and sometimes up to 100 other public access producers slamming me. And there were times where they tracked down not my current agents, old agents of mine that I had fired years ago that like were on there, and they'd say like, we've CC'd his agents from the Gersh agency to make sure they're aware. This ended, I'm not kidding, almost no one knows this. They sued me in federal court.
What?
I was sued in federal court by a very Wayne-esque man. I don't want to name his name
because
he monitors everything I do. But
was another producer of a different show?
Yes, yes.
What was the charge of not cleaning up their
food? Do you want the full background? How long do we have?
Let's unlimited.
Feel free to edit. So he invited me to be part. He was running a show. Where do you even start? He was running a show that was basically his effort to do a sort of like America's Got Talent-esque show. And he asked me to come be a judge. I said, I'd love to. I didn't know him at all, but I was like, yeah, public access, community.
Yep.
I'd love to be a part of things, meet people who are doing other shows. Sounds fun. And then I booked work in Los Angeles, and I emailed him about a month out and said, hey, I'm going to have to reschedule. I got work in California. He didn't even answer. I followed up. Just want to make sure you got this. Didn't hear from him. And that from that point on, it was all out war.
But to sue somebody in federal court, that takes a lot of work. It takes a lot of money, and it takes a lot of work.
It goes on.
Does he have money?
I don't know. Wow. What I do know
is,
so the past two presidential elections, MNN has had me do a 12-hour long broadcast to cover their presidential election. The idea being, there's a lot of people doing serious news. MNN right. has, at my time, it was four networks. They have four channels on Manhattan Cable. They were like, we have the real stuff from our political shows, and if you want the funny, catch your breath, try not to worry about stuff for mm-hmm. a while, you go watch this Gethard thing. I bring in all these comedians, it's fun. So they scheduled this 12-hour thing, and one of those hours, he had the studio booked. They bumped him.
Oh.
He flew into a rage. He wandered onto our live broadcast at one point and removed a piece of furniture. This was in 2012. And we were like, dude, you can't wear... And he was like, oh, I'm sorry, are you live? I just wouldn't imagine they'd let anyone do this for this long, like on the air.
Whoa.
One point, do you know Connor Ratliff? Connor Ratliff's a pretty brilliant improviser. He does a lot of work on our show. At one point, he kind of like ran up to Connor, and Connor was in character because he'd been doing bits all day. And he like started yelling at Connor, and Connor, am I allowed to curse?
Yeah.
Connor just turned around to him and was like, you don't want to fuck with me, man. I can get as crazy as you can. He ran away. So,
in character or as himself?
Connor just kind of gave it to this guy because he was like all amped up from doing this like aggressive bit. Fuck off, dude. So then what else? Then I would get put on these emails, people shitting all over my show. I'd have to write back reply all and go, hey, everybody, just so you know, it's Chris, I'm on here, so if any of you don't want me knowing your opinion, just like feel free. Like if you want to give it to me, give it to me. But if you don't want me, understand that they CC'd me on this. There was like a cabal of them. One of them would just say like, I don't really understand how this show has any place on the culture channel of the Manhattan Neighborhood Network. And I'd go, well, it's a comedy show. And I don't think you can, like, the first stand-up comedy club was in Manhattan. There's such a long tradition. Like, I think the culture of New York is kind of inherently tied to comedy at this point. She'd go, no, fuck that, this and that. I looked up her show. I was going back and forth with her for a long time. I looked up her show. No joke. One of the first clips I found was her interviewing a man who is an admitted child molester. He's been to prison for child molestation, who claims that he's been visited by angels and can travel between dimensions. That's what they were talking about.
Oh, and we gotta find that video.
Oh, I can show it to you.
Oh, you have it?
It's on the internet. Oh, it's on YouTube. She uploaded it.
Right.
It's like, she's proud of it. So,
that's part of the culture of Manhattan, but your show was not.
So exactly. And then I wrote back, and then I'd be a dick, and I'd write back. I was very good at walking the line and be like, you know, I get that you say my show is not part of the culture, but like part of the beauty of public access is that we all get to kind of have our say. Like, for example, I don't think this is a very cultural piece of New York that we need to hear about, but here's a clip I found of your show. So I'll let everyone else reading this debate which one they think has more merit.
Right.
And just kind of like, there's nothing I said there that was wrong or incorrect.
Right.
Like, I'm not slamming you. I'm not saying this is nuts, but I am saying, like, I don't argue your right to have this.
Wow.
So don't argue my right to have mine. And I will also say, I think that's actually truthfully beautiful. I love that there is a thing that's like, if you want that to be a TV show, we'll give you the airtime.
Oh,
right. Go for
broke.
Right.
That's the beauty of public access.
But it is interesting. It's like, because it's such an insular thing, I think, people felt a little threatened when somebody from who maybe hasn't been there for 15 years came in.
Who wasn't part of the club.
Yeah.
And then years later, it was 2016 or 17. Because I was doing a show off Broadway. And this woman after the show, a friend of mine and his wife and her sister were in my green room, real tiny green room, like this big. And this woman jumps into my green room. She's wearing a coat and sunglasses, like a floor length winter coat, sunglasses. She's like, hey, I got these posters. Will you sign my posters? Will you sign? And I was like, okay. And my instinct immediately was like, something's very wrong here.
Yeah.
So then, but I'm like, I got my buddy here, his wife, her sister. I don't really know them. So I was like, I'm just gonna get her out of here. So I'm like, yep, I'll sign whatever you need, Let's do it. Just get her out of here. I sign the thing. She goes, and I got you a present. And she hands me this wrapped thing. And when I open it, it was papers, federal. She had served me papers. And I guess when you get served papers, you have to sign something.
Yes. We've been served papers before.
I've read about this, yes.
Yeah, but they were sneaky about it. Not that sneaky.
They were sneaky.
That's really sneaky.
Yeah.
That's ambitious.
Yeah.
So signing posters to get you serve your papers for the lawsuit.
I mean, I feel like they're just kind of fucking with you at that point. Just like, open up your present.
Best part of the papers is that he sued about a dozen, he sued me, Manhattan Neighborhood Network, Time Warner Cable, the City of New York, a bunch of individual employees, about a dozen of us. He refers to me over and over again throughout this document as, quote, white comedian Rick Gethard. My name is Chris Gethard. He is also white.
Yeah.
And one of his demands, we had gone to cable at that point, and he said, I don't want money. I want him to have to let me host one of his shows on cable, because he claimed that us bumping him impeded his First Amendment rights.
Wow.
So he sued me in federal court.
Holy cow.
You bumped him because you didn't do, because you didn't do that one show.
We did the election coverage. Oh, the special election event. Coverage. So they were like, hey, dude, we got to reschedule your thing.
Some and poor federal judge has to
not
look
at
that.
Not even we're canceling it, we have to reschedule.
Well, so you mentioned he did kind of a Star Search style show.
He did.
Which is kind of what I have here. This is called Star Performer Showcase. It's from Chicago.
Beautiful.
And we got a couple of friends
home
in
of
Chicago.
One of the great public access shows, Chickagoga.
Yes.
Oh,
home
yes.
of one of the all-time
we were both
classics.
On that show. Oh, yeah. Have you been on it before?
I have not.
On your list.
Still
I would
on
love
the
to.
Air.
Would
and
love to.
It's been going on the air for, I don't know, it's
You're talking Chickagoga?
Yeah.
Yeah.
20 some years now. So this is from May 2002, and this is a guy named Stan Fischel this is sort of like they do karaoke, and so here's a little bit of Stan.
I've never seen this one before.
No, I just watched it this morning.
Sorry, I just talked.
No,
for
I
a
love
long
this.
Time.
Great.
So sorry.
Andy.
Yes.
And now coming on stage.
We meet again.
Yes, our official booty inspector with the official booty of the crew here today, Athena. You recruited her, right?
Yeah, she's the booty girl.
Yeah, he was down in Florida checking booties out. Steve Fischel, our official booty inspector.
Yeah, but they never had any beautiful booties like she has down there.
No, nothing like Chicago.
No.
What are you going to do for us?
Let's hang on.
We got to do this quick because he's got to get back to the birthday cake that he was
Rocky,
walked away
when
from.
When you throw a party, you throw a heck of a good party here.
They're out there taking off their clothes and everything, right?
Thanks, Rocky.
Steve.
Bottom of a swimming pool?
It's a tarp.
That's definitely a tarp.
So they had to hurry up, so this is kind of waiting for the music track to start.
He looks a lot like
Due to technical difficulties. Step.
He looks a lot like Gorilla.
Just be sure you don't have any taps on your shoes on this brand new floor here at Cafe USA. Let's hang it.
Everybody having a great time today?
There we go.
Does not come from an improv background.
This is 2002.
Yeah.
There ain't no good in our goodbye. True love takes a lot of
the idea
trying.
Was like agents might see
oh,
this and
baby, I'm
they
out
and say that?
Come on, everybody.
So this is like a sizzle reel.
Yeah.
Wait, did this air on public access?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Let's hang on to what we got.
Don't let go, girl. Looks to be a very plain painting tarp behind me, right?
Yeah, I think that's what it is, yeah. It's
maybe
like high-tech.
Maybe a pool cover, maybe?
Yeah. All right, that's probably enough of Steve Fischel. But yeah, they would say, that's Steve Fischel, you can reach him here if you want to book him or hire him.
Have you seen Stairway to Stardom at all? It's New York's version of that show. It's like their local, Star Search kind of a show.
I wonder if that's the one they tried to book me on. Is it a public access
show? It finished in 1991.
It went from 78 to 92. So it ran a long time.
Beautiful.
But there's always usually one of these shows.
Yeah.
And actually, a quick Manhattan Neighborhood Network thing. We shot a bit at there. I think we wanted to do like our own public access show and show some highlights from it. And so we did the joke was that I was hosting a show called Talking Beards that had been running for 20 years. And it was all about beard maintenance and Chris Elliott came on and did the show, and so they gave us like a half hour to use their equipment and tape it.
Oh, they're the best.
And so we actually like hired an actor to play a rabbi because we thought it'd be a funny scene of me just interviewing a rabbi about a beard. And so we had a guy play a rabbi who wasn't really one. And then right after we finished shooting that half hour, six rabbis showed up for the rabbi talk show. Like, we couldn't have made that up.
That's perfect.
Yeah. So how did the federal lawsuit end? Did you settle or did he drop it or did it was dismissed?
Of course it's going to be dismissed. The judge was basically like, I don't even know what I'm reading.
Yeah,
right.
Exactly.
I don't know what this is. Yeah.
It probably cost that guy like $30,000 to do that too. I mean,
One of my favorite things about public access is that there's no... All the rules are driven by the community standards. So obscenity is famously what does the community.
And nudity too. Sometimes you turn on there's
I was just gonna the
Sandy
show,
Kane.
Yeah. Sandy Kane. Yeah. She was on our show for a while.
Oh wow.
Yeah. Yeah. She dropped by, just stuck around for a while, and then there was a show that followed ours called Sub-Zero TV. Mm-hmm. The rule with men, you're not allowed to be naked in the studio, but that's a cleanliness issue.
Okay.
They just don't want people's balls
touching their chairs. Same rule here. We have the same rule here. Yeah.
But the show that followed our Sub-Zero TV was just straight up women dancing, boobs, full vagina shots, asshole shots.
When you're 14 years old, I mean, you live for shows like
that. It was incredible.
Like pre-internet especially, like, man.
This one would be like, it would be like 7 minutes of close-ups of genitals, and then it would just cut to like a brawl in a parking lot, and then cut back to body parts. Wait, it's an incredible show.
Did you say they're assholes? Did I hear you correctly?
Yeah, close-ups. Okay. Right. Close-ups.
Well, that's the community standards in Manhattan.
No, as long as nobody complains.
Cultural significance in assholes, right?
Yeah. Sure. Yeah.
All right. I'm going to show you this. Do you know Jeff Krulik, Heavy Metal Parking Lot? Have you heard of him?
Okay. Yes, yes.
So he got his start at Public Access. Mm-hmm. And when we started doing this show, he's like, oh, I got a bunch of stuff. So he handed us
tons
of stuff. Yeah, from Bethesda?
I don't know. Yeah, I think somewhere in Maryland outside D.C.
But anyway, he gave us this one called The Hypnotist, mm-hmm. which I think it's over 300 episodes this guy did. He explains it in here. Maybe I'll just have him explain it. But
this is fascinating.
Yeah, this is fascinating. We only have one episode. I want all 300-plus episodes. But I'll just this speaks for itself, so I'll just let...
Hello, Harmony friends, and welcome back to the Hypnotist Program. This is our 331st broadcast of the Hypnotist series, and I am sure that you're going to enjoy what you are about to see. This program will be dedicated to the scientific community, in which, of course, any professional hypnotist will enjoy. This is to be attempted only by the most serious and capable hypnotists that there are.
I love public access.
At this time, I shall endeavor to place my wife Stella into a depth trance. The count of five, which she is already in, has given her the property of unconsciousness. Every count thereafter will go deeper and deeper into a tranced state. If it were possible, and this has happened, she has gone to 112 deaths.
That's a great reveal, isn't it?
Stella.
Wait, what?
112 is at least 20 times deeper and further than unconsciousness.
Are we certain she's alive?
Whatever is about to happen, this is very, very serious.
She's in a trance, but
our general
this is
manager
really disturbing.
Has been instructed.
I mean, if you didn't have sound, if you caught this without sound, you'd call the police.
If you had this on mute,
this is
honorable and, if possible, scientific.
And the name of the show is The Hypnotist. Yeah. So this is,
and
he's done
Stella,
some version of this 330
another
times.
Another breath or two to activate yourself.
Oh, no.
Now I am at the end of the tunnel. There is nothing around me except decadence.
I find this genuinely chilling.
Oh, it is.
I don't like this.
And it kind of looks like Vincent Price.
The trees are down.
So the trees are down.
There is rotten grass all around me.
Oh, God.
And I am trying not to step in the water because the water has a bad odor to it. And there are some rocks in the water. And I'm going to try to step on them so I do not get my feet wet.
Well, I decided to end it there, but
You know, the thing is, they usually do with hypnotists or with magicians, they're always like, bring somebody in the audience that they don't know. I feel like it's kind of stacking the deck if it's his wife every time on the show.
Yeah, you
know,
see,
she could just be making up the hypnosis.
I texted Jeff before I decided to air that, and I was just like, can you give me any sort of background? I didn't hear back from him. But
I remember him telling me that the couple would drive like 3 hours to come.
I think that they're from Pennsylvania, and they came down to, I remember
to,
that.
To use the equipment and do
331 times they did
Jeff
that.
Did Jeff produce all 330 of those?
I mean, that's a good question. I don't know about that. I would doubt it. I mean, that seems
that
like that's...
wild.
How many episodes did you do on MNN before you did the True TV show and the...
We did... over 150.
Wow.
And then we did a...
Weekly?
Yeah, weekly. And then we did a bunch of specials and two of those 12-hour election things. So I think I generated over... I mean, before I judged their 331 episodes, I generated over 200 hours
that's
of public access
great.
Content. So I cannot cast stones on
that.
But that's really over 3 years, huh? You did that?
It was about four and a half years, I
think. Okay.
Yeah.
But you didn't make money doing that, did
you? I lost a lot of money.
Did you have a day job or something, or were you doing comedy? Or?
Yeah, I was doing comedy, and I was I had already kind of been up and running. So I booked a job on a sitcom in 2010, and this was like all my friends from UCB. This was when UCB had become like such a hit factory, where all these people were coming out. And everybody was kind of like, man, how come you can't catch a job? You got to be the next guy. And then it just wasn't happening. You were around for this. Like, it was sort of becoming like, I was sort of in some circles becoming a little bit of a cautionary tale of like, don't do it
not
forever.
Not everybody can expect,
of like, not everybody. And then I got this sitcom and it bombed so hard. And
there what was it?
It was called Big Lake. It was on Comedy Central. And I didn't write the show or pitch the show or anything. I was just an actor. The guy who played Napoleon Dynamite got fired, and I was hired on like days' notice.
Is this after Napoleon Dynamite?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So I was replacing this well-known guy, and then we were shooting like 5 or 6 days later, if I remember right. And I just got creamed. And I remember so clearly just having that thought of like, if I ever get crushed like this again, it's going to be for something that I actually give a shit about.
Yeah.
And that was a big motivator to go on public access. Was I was definitely sort of licking my wounds, but I just did not want to do other people's stuff. I couldn't, my ego could not handle reading all this terrible stuff for myself.
Right.
I didn't write it. Like, I got thrown into the maelstrom and did my best, and you know, I'd rather just go do something that's mine, and the only place that would let me do my thing was public access.
Have you ever like considered releasing like all the public access episodes?
They're all on YouTube.
They're all on YouTube.
Really?
Yeah, The 2016 election special is not.
Yeah.
Because it's incredibly dark, as you can imagine. It got really, really fucked up and sad.
Yeah.
You still do it every election?
I would do it, and if they want me to do 2020, I'll do it. It got really dark and everybody was fighting, and I just said, for the sake of everybody involved in this thing, I'm not going to put this out here because.
Yeah. Right.
But you modeled your True TV show after that, then, right?
Yeah, we were on a network called Fusion for 2 seasons.
Yeah, I remember.
Very,
the
very small.
Oh, that's right.
One.
I remember that.
Yeah. And those are all on YouTube as well, and True TV won't let us put ours on YouTube. So those are kind of the ones that are lost to time. But there's close to 200 episodes that just live on YouTube if anybody wants to watch them.
I recently rewatched the dumpster episode.
That's the one everybody loves the most.
I know everyone loves that. It's a good place to start, just of how anarchic and how amazing that show
is. I think that to me is the closest we ever came to public access with money.
Yeah.
That's the most. And the funny thing is that out of all of our network years, I swear to you, I'm not making this up. That is the one that we would fight and fight and fight with these network executives, and they would tell us what to do, and we'd be like, that's not the show you bought. That was the one where we said, please let us just do one our way.
Please let us do one our way.
And that's the one everybody loves. That's the one that people talk about to this day.
Yeah, and it's like, to me, it's like, I mean, it's its own thing, but like when you think about like the early like Letterman stuff, and I mean it's like a bit like that but expanded to the whole episode.
That was always obviously, I think anyone who would watch my show would go, he's just ripping off Letterman and trying to like concentrate it down to just the bizarre parts, like no monologue jokes.
It's its own thing,
interviews.
You know,
yeah, it grew that way, but that was one of the early. It was Uncle Floyd, it was Conan, it was Letterman, it was the Channel 9 Howard Stern show, it was a lot of that. Steam Pipe Alley. I don't know if you guys
know. I don't know. Steam Pipe Alley.
Oh my God. Steam Pipe Alley was this show on Channel 9 in New York, WPIX.
Yep.
That was, for most of my life, Channel 9 and 11 were just, they weren't, you know, WB, UPN, they were local stations. Steam Pipe Alley, you would love this. It's a very, very bizarre kids show that was hosted by Mario Cantone.
Oh, yeah, the Broadway.
Mario Cantone is a Broadway actor, comedian. He's on Sex and the City. He's a stand-up. Oh, okay. He's a pretty flamboyant gay man who they let host this kids show where it'd be almost his version of Double Dare. So he'd be having the
and
kids.
And this was like, his start, I assume.
Yeah, okay. So it'd be like he'd have kids jumping into like a kiddie pool full of pudding, and then he'd sing a song while impersonating Bette Midler, and then it would like cut to like a Porky Pig cartoon.
Oh, whoa.
And then it would come back to him like yelling
at gay Bozo or something.
It was wow. And it was really, it was actually very, I would say very inspiring.
Oh my God. All right, well, Steam Pipe Alley, we're looking into.
Yeah, you would
I have another New York show that maybe you've seen this. This is on Queens Public Access. I taped a lot of these episodes. This particular one was taped by a friend of a friend, and it's a show called Goddesses. Have you ever seen this one?
No. This is QPTV,
QPTV,
right?
QPTV.
Yeah.
And I guess then it aired on the Staten Island and Manhattan networks,
because we should also talk. Do you guys know about the Staten Island comedy show?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Have you done it? I've never done it.
I was on it once
Nick
and showed
it,
some clips, and I knew Charlie Sanders was on it. And
Charlie was the one who first told me about it.
Yes, me too. So he championed that show, and we have a bunch of Staten Island comedy
shows. Notoriously bizarre.
Oh, it's so good.
You have some footage of it, right?
Yeah,
like, you have some tapes.
I do.
Yeah.
I got
should dive into that.
It's still going, right?
Yeah, I think they still do it. Yeah. We'll show that on another episode. But this one is a show by this woman who calls herself Nancy Goddess. And she is a large woman. She calls herself fat. And this show is a celebration of the sex appeal of fat women.
Great.
And the people who appreciate it. And this particular episode, they have a guy on. His name is like Salance or something like that. And he is he writes songs about large women and his love for them. And he has a partner who he's developed a routine with. Mm-hmm. So here's some highlights from this particular episode of Goddesses. Let me rewind a little bit, just so you can see the beginning.
He wants to be in the middle. Look at him. I mean, like you being smothered with two beautiful women.
Yeah.
He's in his glory.
Show me the money.
Show you the money. That'll be your next song.
No, that's been done. Oh, yeah, that... That could be a song.
Absolutely. Are you still doing your water aerobics?
Yeah, every day. 5 days a week.
You're kidding me. Not only do you...
I just want to rewind that because you can't really hear it.
What's she
but
saying?
She goes, are you still doing your water aerobics? And she goes, 5 days a week. And goes, you go, girl.
You go, girl.
Absolutely. Are you still doing your water aerobics?
Yeah, every day. 5 days a week.
You're kidding me. Not only do you rap and write songs, you also do mail review, don't you?
Yes, exotic entertainment. Yes, I do.
Exotic entertainment. I'm trying you call
to, you know, I'm thinking of putting the package together, the music and the dancing.
Talk to me, baby.
Yes.
I need a plus size around the clock.
It's called plus size is happening.
We can do it all night while I sex the spot. Come on.
Yes.
I want to see your act. So what are we waiting for?
98.
Let's do it. So next we're going to see Ellen and Donald in their act.
Oh, wait, sorry. I talked over this part, but this is a pretty good detail. They're introducing the two-person.
I want to see your act. So what are we waiting for? Let's do it. So next we're going to see Ellen and Donald in their act.
Happy Mother's Day,
it's about size. Woo. It's about weight.
Yes.
And how big women really are great.
Yeah, yeah, yeah,
yeah, yeah. Wait, did she write the song?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, that's Goddesses. That's a little bit. And by the way, that show's still on.
Sort of beautiful.
Yeah,
though.
From '96. It's really great. It's empowering. They have big girl, big women lingerie shows. The next one's on May 10th, and you can go see
goddesses.
It in Brooklyn.
I see goddesses all the time come up on. It's, you know what I like? It's on the like the menu on cable. If you hit the menu, they have all that stuff
you
up there.
You can DVR it.
Yeah, you can DVR goddesses. All right, we're gonna end on something. This is probably the darkest one. So this we're gonna go over to Los Angeles for this one. Los Angeles has so much great public access. There's so much stuff out there. Harvey Sid Fisher. There's just so many. Oh yeah, the guy who's on the treadmill.
Is it the treadmill?
Yeah.
I think he's now an internet show. He started.
Is he?
And his is really dark too, because he'd take calls, and I've seen a lot of episodes where the calls are just like members of different street gangs calling out and like shouting out their block, and then other people calling up to be like, nope, that's not okay.
That's one thing that we didn't include in this is call-ins. Like we have so many great call-ins where they're just, you know, they
and I know on your podcast you probably have some, I mean, you have to deal with calls every week, right?
I love it. So. Well, I started the podcast because when we switched to cable, I really missed the phone calls from our public access. Some of my favorite moments from our public access run are phone calls. We got, in our early days, it was just people pranking us, and it was so fun. And in our later days, it was just people from literally all over the world calling up and saying whatever was on their mind, and I just missed it.
Yeah. Oh,
so great. Yeah. Yeah. Well, Nick and I used to be the ones who would call up to the public access shows, too.
Yeah.
1,000%.
You've been on both ends. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. So this one, our friend Eileen from Memphis gave us this one. Her friend records a ton of public access stuff off of Los Angeles television. This show's called The Thomas O'Dady Explosion. Uh-huh. And we got two episodes of the show, and they're very, very different. The first one, you can tell something's off with him. He's angry. You'll see what he's angry about.
Yeah.
And then the second episode, it's off the rails. And so that's all we have. I don't know how many episodes he has. We want to do a documentary on this guy.
Yeah. Like
there's so many questions about this guy.
I would imagine Los Angeles public access is a particular, you're in the center of the entertainment industry.
Yes.
So if you want to be on TV, there's probably got to be a particular level of desperation.
Exactly.
Which again, I can't judge because it's what led me to public
access. I was just going to say, I feel like it's a lot of people in the same boat that you were in.
But like, I would imagine it's amplified.
Oh, yeah.
Because you landed in LA. You went for it.
You want to be seen.
There's so many. Mr. Morrison, the guy who does balloon animals and swears. Uh-huh. Oh, man, he's so great. All right, here's Thomas O'Dady Explosion. I don't like it when it starts right in the middle. Yeah, we want to at the beginning. Here we go.
Hello. Welcome to another edition of the Thomas O'Dady Explosion.
He seems happy though now.
This program is specifically geared for one of the most abused people in our nation today, Jehovah's Witnesses, believe it or not.
It's all about Jehovah's Witnesses.
If you become a Jehovah's Witness, you will never vote again. You will never salute our flag. As far as my 7-year-old son, Jesse Abraham O'Dady, and his 5-year-old sister, my daughter, Hosanna Elizabeth O'Dady, and their mother, Leona Maria O'Dady, is concerned, you Watchtower publishers, you can have my family over my dead body.
Okay.
He thought the Watchtower was trying to take away his family?
The whole thing's about the Watchtower and about how they're trying to take his family away from him, and who knows what's actually going on, because he doesn't explain it that well. And it's a full hour of that. And then the next episode, I think it cuts in the middle, so I didn't have the whole thing, but this is roughly when it begins, of part two of the Thomas O'Dady Explosion.
Or shape of this... of this thing we tolerated
the same man?
200 years ago, 200 years ago, just upwards of
different
until 1856, 1860, 1863.
Yeah, it's a Hellraiser shirt.
Oh.
And Brother Hank Williams Jr.
Brother Hank Williams Jr.
You start reading about our Union General Meade. We salute the flag.
All those paintings, right?
Yeah, I want one so bad.
Flag on, says I pledge allegiance to the flag. of the United States of America. Kids, put your hands up to your heart.
Is it a wig?
The United States of America.
The art's pretty cool.
Let's get a picture of our flag there, please.
Okay. We got it.
And to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all, including Jehovah's Witnesses.
Now
thank
he's
you.
Back. He's back.
Mom, I love you. Hmm. I'll have some flowers for you next time at the next show. I miss you, and I love you. And you have two beautiful grandchildren, Jesse and Hosanna.
Is this Hank Williams?
Ooh.
Brother?
I think it's one.
Oh, yeah.
I'm surprised he used copyrighted music. It's a big no-no.
Yeah.
Big no-no.
But this is the closing credits that goes on for...
Is it like a bullwhip?
The song is like 9 minutes long. Yeah, it's like a bullwhip.
I mean, so, if you're flipping channels, how are you going
to... How do you say no to this?
Yeah.
So then we found out, through the friend of a friend, we had dinner with this guy who recorded this. He said he ran into Thomas O'Dady at a Ross Dress for Less. You know those Ross Dress for Less?
Yeah, yeah.
He said that he ran into him there, and he said he was just perfectly normal.
Really?
Yeah.
Did he bring up the show to him?
I don't know.
I thought I remember him saying he was too afraid to say anything.
Yeah.
He was sure it was him.
Yeah.
He's weirdly fit.
Yeah. So, I mean, this goes on forever.
We're going to get a copyright.
We definitely will.
Yeah.
It'll be worth it, though.
So, yeah, you do get stuff on the margins, and then you have community affairs shows, mm-hmm. and then you get, but all of them are operating without a net. So
yes.
And I think that's what we like, is sort of this unvarnished look at, I mean, you know, because I think the things that we really respond to are the technical difficulties, the having to improvise. And,
yes.
I mean, just... It's just so much more interesting than a polished, you know,
it can
program.
Be so joyous.
Yeah.
I feel like, would it be okay if I shouted out some of the stuff that I'm like...
Of course.
Yes.
There's people, like, when you think of New York, like, Beyond Vaudeville, which became Oddville on MTV. If you go back and watch old episodes of Beyond Vaudeville, it's awesome. Squirt TV, which Jake Fogelness used to do when he was 13 years old.
Wow.
There was one in Minneapolis I loved. I became friends with these guys. They were kind of... I was building towards trying to like do some stuff with them, but they ended their run right when we were getting started, called Freaky Deaky out of Minneapolis. And a bunch of really cool people did it. There's this one dude named Hamel Griffin Cassidy who became like the child prodigy of Minneapolis Public Access. Started
really?
There when he was a teenager.
What year is this? Dude.
This was,
We both lived in Minneapolis for a while.
He was crossing over with us, so he didn't wrap up Freaky Deaky until about 2012 or 2013.
Okay.
But he did a show that's so funny. You maybe have seen this clip, where his whole show was just an overhead shot of a Scrabble board, and you could call in and make the next move.
Oh,
and then he'd
make,
so it was
that's
him versus
idea.
The whole world. And he told me, he's like, yeah, I just wanted to do it because I wanted people to call up and scream at me.
That's a great
idea. Yeah, and built this show Freaky Deaky. It was people dancing, and they did a lot of stuff. Where he once did a whole thing where there were like green screens, and people were running them, and his cameras following green screens down hallways as they converted the whole hallway and stuff. Like,
oh, wow.
Brilliant stuff. And then there's TV Party, right? That's a famous one. Glenn O'Brien, right? And then what's
the one?
There's one in L.A. I read a book about this guy. Oh, what is the name of the one? TV Party was New York, and that one, fucking Basquiat was the DJ. And
no way.
Yeah, like... That whole like late Factory Warhol scene would come. This was like an extension of that public access show. And there was one in LA that I can't believe I'm blanking on the name. The guy who hosts...
Dancing with Frank Buchowski?
I wouldn't know that. The host was the guy. He wrote... Do you know the song? I think it's from Eraserhead. The In Heaven, Everything is Fine.
Yeah.
His name's Peter Ivers. He hosted one. And they used to have on like all the early punk bands from LA.
Yeah.
And then Bill Murray would be on it, and Harold Ramis, like all the Second City guys.
I bet
guys.
This guy Art Fine, the guy who gave us Thomas O'Dady, I bet he just knows
and
everything
Chicago
from that.
Chicago.
On, like, the Blacklips and all these crazy.
Yeah. OK Go built some of their like first big videos off of Chicago Go, I think.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I think that.
Wow.
They did a famous one that I think was, they just released their video as their performance on Chicago Go.
I think the heartbreaking thing about public access for us is so much of it just hasn't been archived because it was up to the producers to hang on to tapes. And I mean, we had a public access show in high school. We'd just tape over the episode before it.
Wayne Brian Meyer, like one kid's opinion, like nobody would see those videos if like we hadn't popped the tape in.
I will tell you that in 2011, and I am not throwing shade to any employees at MNN, they know how much love I have for it. In 2011, no one could explain to us how to tape our own show and bring it home with us. Like, we could have probably watched it on TV and I guess burned it from that, but as far as the actual equipment, like, and we had NYU film graduates working on our show who had to go in and figure out what equipment we had to buy and bring with us to get those tapes so we could archive it ourselves.
Yeah, it's and if nobody did, like, it was hard to do, so if nobody did it, then you were just kind of stuck. So that's the part we always kick ourselves over, is so much stuff that we could have saved. So you have to rely on collectors and producers who are still around.
Tell us about your stuff. You have a podcast that sounds really cool, and you got a book out.
Yes, I have a podcast called Beautiful Anonymous where I take phone calls, and I just wrote a book called Lose Well and other stuff. But I will say, I probably am not supposed to announce it yet, but I will tease you guys and say this is serendipitous timing because
You got a public access.
I have a new. I'm gonna do a new public access project. Are you serious?
Yes. Are you kidding me? Project.
Oh, I'm still joke. No, well, that was. A lot of people have said like you should go back to public access, and initially I was like, no, you can't move backwards, and now I think, I can move. I have found a good way to move backwards that I will feel very proud of.
I'm gonna say you're moving forward. I think let's look at it that way.
Are you actually doing it on a public access channel, or is it?
I'm going to be. I don't want to say too much.
Okay.
But I will say that I will be finding new ways to pass the torch at the Manhattan Neighborhood Network to a younger generation. I had great success there and a great time there. First of all, most importantly, creatively, I got to run wild in a way that no one else would let me do. And then we managed to take that pretty far to two different cable networks.
I'm wondering, do young people go on to public access? I feel like they just do YouTube
now,
YouTube,
right?
Why would they do public access?
They do, but I actually think there's a lot of benefit to public access. A, deadlines.
Yeah.
B, the equipment. Like when we got to the studio, my the guy who was like my right-hand man on the show, my friend JD, he went through NYU and he was like, we could not afford to rent this studio.
Yeah.
He's like, this is good equipment.
For sure.
We could not afford this.
Yeah.
It's good equipment. It's a community. It has deadlines. It has, you know, certain, for as much as I was given a hard time by people, there's also like a certain competitiveness about like, we got to bring it. And there's a lot of reasons that I really wound up loving it. And most importantly, they don't care what you do. They actually, the people who run that place have a policy where they do not watch shows on their own network, because if they have the power to cancel them and they are offended personally, they don't want to be tempted to cancel something.
Right.
So they just wait until people complain.
That's a huge endorsement.
Yeah.
I think that's the best reason to go on cable.
And your show's
going to
be all buttholes though, right?
It's close-ups of buttholes. I mean, this show was close-ups of buttholes, fist fighting. Another guy who followed us, he just passed away. His name was Vinny Vella. He was a dude who, he had very small parts in The Sopranos and Goodfellas, like a bunch of mob movies. It was just him and his friends hanging out and with just like hot girls and skimpy outfits. Like that was the whole show. Like this, everything that happens there is just wild.
Well, come back when this new project
comes.
We'll watch some more public action.
Don't watch one more.
This was so fun.
I have Finders Keepers. Do we have time for Finders Keepers? I feel like we ended on like on a down
note. Yeah, let's end up on Finders Keepers.
Also, I talk too much. I'm so sorry.
No, this is why we had you on.
Is this like three times longer than a
standard
episode?
No, this is great.
It really, it probably is. You're all being very nice.
All right, Finders Keepers. This one was a hit. We played this one a couple weeks ago. It was a hit. It's these two women who have this public access show. I don't know where it's from because they have a phone number. They don't have the area code up.
Uh-huh.
They just have the seven numbers.
And so is it old?
It's old. It's 1990, does it say? 1997.
Okay.
So we're
just switching over to area code at that point,
right?
Yeah,
probably some new area codes. Yeah,
because I don't think cell phones were a thing then.
Yeah, you only need an area code for long distance. Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
Exactly. So they have the show where they find things on the ground and they bring them up on the show.
Perfect.
And they describe where they found them, and then people have to call in to say if it was theirs, and they have to convince them that it's theirs.
I wonder if there's ever been one successful finding.
From what I watch all 35 minutes today. There's never a successful
one. Do you know Davey Rothbard?
Yes.
Does he know about this?
He's a friend of ours. Yeah.
He
doesn't know about the show,
about
but I'm going to tell him about it for sure.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So this one is a bong. They found a bong, and a guy calls up and claims that he knows what it is. And these two, like, you're never going to have more fun than these two have on the screen.
Tell us about the bong.
Tell us.
I want the bong. I can't tell the bong that you have on. Can you
just say, can you show it? Can you show it? I can show it.
These are my people. These are the people having
fun. Yeah, it's a purple one.
So does it say on the bottom, does it have a sticker on the bottom?
No.
No.
Oh, what does the sticker say on the bottom?
The sticker, it's like a fish sticker.
And what color is it?
A fish sticker?
Well, mine was blue like and purple.
Haha! It's not your bong.
These are my people.
Why would he lose that giant so four foot?
This is like a greatest hits tape that somebody edited together for us.
It's okay, so dolphin. It's okay. And somebody
we gotta
did surgery
know.
On it.
And I did Google searches for losers weepers.
They threw him out of the hospital right into the street.
Every once in a while, it's the perfect blend of like.
He needs help right away. He needs
still
home.
Sort of
he
insane,
needs
but also creative.
Yeah.
That's them. That's these two. Yeah.
And they're so excited. I know these kids in Houston do a great show. These kids in Massachusetts.
Hello?
I'm seeing an outfit.
Oh, Zoe! That's because you didn't write us down in your date book.
Okay, sweatshirt. I'm putting in 3 votes for sweatshirt.
Oh! I have no idea what
the audio is.
It's just like,
so bad.
2 seconds, okay, bye.
And everybody claims they might be there, right?
Oh, that's so good.
Yeah.
So funny. Such a funny idea.
It really is a funny
idea. It's simple,
idea.
But sustainable.
Yeah.
And yeah. Well, thank you for coming on, and I loved the stories, loved the insight on public access.
This was a joy.
Come
I
back.
Could talk about it all night.
It's a white comedian Chris Gethard.
Rick Gethard, yes. White comedian Rick Gethard.
Rick Gethard.
Yes.
I missed that part.
So,
white comedian Rick Gethard, everybody.
Why?
And there you have it.
Wow.
Yep.
Great segment. Could have talked for hours, but
yep.
We'll have him back.
Yeah.
Quality dude. That was great. So I wanted to just quickly recap, because right after this, or probably tomorrow, I'm going to post the voting for the EP mode episode. So again, these are the super long episodes where we just watch a video in its entirety. We mentioned that McSee is going to be one of the ones up for vote.
Vote for that one. Just vote for that
but
one.
But we also saw One Kid's Opinion with Chris.
One Kid's Opinion is good,
too. And
that's
great. I know. I think Bob Hedges, who gave us the stripogram, wants One Kid's Opinion.
Yeah.
But we also, the other one we mentioned was Mr. T's Be Somebody and Be Somebody's Fool.
Yeah.
Which is one I found at I think it was a Blockbuster in Madison in the bargain bin.
Yeah, I think that's where it was. I remember going over to your place and watching that one and just being
so many classic moments. So I'm just going to show, if you haven't seen this, there's an educational video by
Mr.
I'll
be curious to see which scene you select.
This is just where the tape was. And this was a free rental, I think, a lot of times, because it was educational.
Yeah.
So this is just, but the whole video is great. Here's a little bit.
I was hoping to do this. Treat Your Mother Right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Watch some of these scenes, and also the guy from It's Gary Shandling showed wearing biker gloves and massaging his mom.
I think this is genuinely a good song.
Yeah. Where's T? What's this? He gives his mom a fake Whitman sampler, but he got her a real one.
Mother!
He wasn't treating her right, but with chocolates he was.
Mother,
there he is.
It's a great song.
My mother. So treat her right.
What if we got Mr. T on this show?
I was just going to say that. I bet we could. He seems attainable.
I read his biography, and you know like a lot of celebrity autobiographies, you know, it's like with somebody, or they don't say it, but it's clearly written. Mr. T wrote this, 100%. It's got, it's written how he talks. It's pretty great. But
like no editor,
no.
There's misspellings, there's
nope.
like,
straight from T's words to the page.
All right, we got to wrap things up here. Do we got anything else? Is that it?
That's wrapping it
up? Yep, all right, we're going to leave you with a little Thomas O'Dady explosion.
Okay.
We're going to finish up that song.
His credits going out, and
his little dance with the bullwhip and the
war paint.
So I'm gonna go ahead and say that's it.
Okay, that's all that's it. We'll see you next week. Good night, everybody.
Bye.
left alone.